apresentando User Experience in a Rapidly Changing World, Josh Seiden.
All right, thank you very much. I am so excited to be here. It's incredible to see so many people here. And I just want to thank the organizers. Can we all just thank the conference organizers for a moment? What a great job. This conference has such a great feeling, and it makes me so happy to see this community thriving really around the world. Okay? So, this is what I look like. I'm going to be talking to you tonight about some ideas from my book. If you are interested in the ideas and you like them, you can tweet about them under the hashtag LeanUX. And if you think I'm crazy, you can also tweet about them under that hashtag. I'm going to talk to you about two things tonight. I want to talk about, first, the world that we live in now. I would say pretty much all of us work most of our lives with software. And software's changed a great deal in the last 10, 20 years. I want to talk about that change and some of the, you know, what that change is like, what is the material of that change. And then I want to talk about how we work in this new world. How can we adapt our practice to this, to the changing conditions that we find ourselves in? When I first started working at a design firm, this was in the mid-90s, we had a business model that was very traditional for design firms. It's the same business model that design firms have used, I don't know, perhaps forever, but certainly for many, many years, when the work that we did was primarily with physical materials. This, for example, is a corporate identity system. You know, in our jobs, we would design the system, we would get the system, the designs to the printer, we would get the designs printed, we'd get them to the client, everybody was happy, and we were done. Okay? So our project model, our management model, was a was based around projects, based around deliverables, based around getting them to the printer. And similarly, working with software engineers, the engineering tradition was also based around a sort of a manufacturing process. Right? If you were designing a bridge, you had to figure everything out in advance before you could start building it. Because you didn't have it all figured out, right? The bridge would fall down, people would die. But so as an engineer, you figure it all out, you get the bridge built, you're done, you walk away. Before I worked as a designer, I worked as a product manager in a technology company. And this was my first job, and I knew that I was starting to get somewhere. My first really exciting task at this company, when I was starting to get some responsibility, I got to be the guy who made the golden master copies. This was thrilling to me, because making the golden master was really, really important, right? You had to make a perfect copy of the software, make sure there were no bugs, make sure everything was just right on the disk, and then we'd send the disk to the duplicator, and we would make tens of thousands of copies, and each one of those copies cost a dollar. Okay? And then we would put them in boxes, and we would ship them around the world. And we would do that two times a year, three times a year, maybe four times a year. And if we got it wrong, it was incredibly expensive. If we packed out bad software, right, that software would be living in China and Brazil and Singapore and New York and Paris for years. Right, and we would get telephone calls for it. So did you all start your day with putting floppy disks in your computers? Right, that's not how we consume software now. Right? We consume software, we buy apps in the App Store, we download software in our web browsers, This is Etsy. This is a company in the US. Etsy became famous for making popular a technique called continuous integration and continuous delivery. So Etsy became famous because they delivered new software live 50 times a day, which I think is very impressive, 50 times a day. And that's becoming normal now. So Facebook delivers new software live twice a day. Now, Amazon, I heard earlier this year, here's a number that blew my mind. Amazon delivers new software live every 11.6 seconds. Blew my mind, okay? So what do, right, in that world? If the way that we manage our projects needs to fundamentally change. What it means is that there is no longer a manufacturing step in software development. So the things that we grew accustomed to when we made goods, hard goods of steel, many of them no longer apply, right? So this is the 1953 Volkswagen, and this is the 1968 Volkswagen. Every year, there's a new Volkswagen. And the marketers, they love that, because every year there's an occasion to talk about this new model. But there are all kinds of problems with that too, right? The problems are that if there's a problem in 1963, you don't get to fix it until 1964. But anyway, all of our management models are built around this concept. And this is not what we're making anymore. We're not making millions and millions of the same thing that we understand well. We're making one system. Typically, we work in a company that has one big system, or a couple of big systems. And those systems connect people. And they're complex. They connect people in ways that we don't really understand. Right? We don't understand the behaviors that are taking place in the system many times until we make those systems live. This is not like a car. So software, mature software, where we are today, software enables continuous change. Okay? We have platforms, we have hosted application servers like Heroku. We have Amazon Web Services, we have all of these, we have GitHub, right? We have version control in the cloud. So we have all of these services that we can use that we don't have to build anymore. We can move faster than we've ever moved before. And if you're not moving that quickly, you can bet that your competition is either moving that quickly or trying to figure out how to move that quickly. So how do we work in this continuous way? The first people to really deal with this question were the software developers who were very close to the material, right? And the response that we've seen to the need to work in a continuous manner, the response has been agile software development techniques. Okay? And this community figured it out. And when this community figured it out, this community meaning the software developers, right? The next communities on the outside had to figure out how to work with them, right? So I don't know about your experience with agile software development, but the first time I ever had to deal with agile software development, I hated it. I thought it was the worst thing in the world. Because none of the ways that I knew how to work were useful or effective in that world. And it took a few years for designers to figure out how to work in an agile context. And we started to see designers talking about agile UX. Set of techniques to work in a continuous way and to work effectively with agile software developers. And so when you talk to companies that have that figured out, where the engineers and the designers have figured out how to work together, they complain because the business people don't know how to work that way. So the next layer out is this business community, and these people are starting to figure it out. And there's a community that's coming together around this idea of lean startup, which is the name of a book by a guy named Eric Ries. And these guys have really embraced, what does it mean to work in a continuous business, right? Can we use these continuous techniques of software development to continuously grow and evolve our business? And I'm gonna talk a little bit at the end of this talk, if I've got time, I'm gonna talk about the next layer out, right? What does an enterprise look like that's functioning in a continuous way? 2 years ago, Mark Andreessen, who is the founder of Netscape, Mark Andreessen wrote an article that said, in the Wall Street Journal, called Software's Eating the World. And he said, every business is a software business. Right? And the only question is, do you know it? That software is slowly taking over every business, right? And some businesses know it, right? The music industry, they know that they are a software business. And publishing, they're starting to deal with it. But slowly and surely, every business that you're in is facing this challenge. How do you work in a continuous way? So for all of us, we're looking at this future. And on the one hand, this is thrilling and exciting for us, right? Because we work in software, and every business is becoming a software business. On the other hand, we've got all these challenges, right? How can we work in this new way? How can we keep up with companies that are pushing new software out every 11, 6 seconds? So I'm gonna talk to you about a few methods that we've observed now in the last few years that I think of as very, very effective techniques for dealing with this world of rapid and continuous change. Talk to you about how to construct your projects so that you have a continuous stream of learning. We'll talk about techniques for framing what you're learning. We'll talk about assumptions and hypotheses, right? How to test and learn as you go. Talk about small teams and why they're important. Talk about making software. We'll talk about how to structure our projects for success, and then we'll talk about what this looks like in your company. Okay? So, I told you about my experience making that floppy disk. About that time in my career, I was working at a company in California. I was a junior product manager. And one day, my boss came into my office, and he was very, very, very excited. He said, "Josh, Josh, 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 Josh. Internet. Now, we were a company that made mice for computers, but I didn't know what an internet mouse was, and I said, "Bill, what's an internet mouse?" And he said, "That's your job." So we spent about a month, my team, my colleagues and I, and we did research, and we came back to our boss and said, "This is a bad idea. There's no such thing as an internet mouse. We shouldn't do it." And he said, no, "We're doing it." And we, as much as we tried to convince him, we couldn't stop him. And so we spent almost a year, and we spent more money than I want to tell you. And we produced this. This is the worst thing I've ever done. And I could talk to you for an hour about this product, but I just want to show you a couple of things. We spent many, many hours arguing about the navigation and whether we should have, what kind of shortcut buttons we should have. Whether we should have this kind or this kind, so we can both. And so on and so on. And So the idea of this internet mouse, this was 1994, and the idea was everyone was going to be buying these big televisions that were in their living rooms, and the televisions would have the internet on them. And people would sit on their couch, and they would need a way to control the television from the couch. And so the idea was this would let you, this was what they called the 10-foot interface, because it was 10 feet away. But the regulations said you could only have a 6-foot cord. So we didn't sell too many. We sold, none. You can go on eBay and get one now. So this is going to happen on all of your projects, right? We start with an idea, and we think, this is a good idea, right? Internet now is going to be big, right? And then we work, and we put it out in the public, and we discover maybe it's a good idea, or maybe it's a bad idea. So this is always going to happen. You're going to think, have an idea, and the public is going to give you the answer about whether it's good or bad. And so the question really is, how long are you going to wait to learn? Right? Are you going to wait months? Or can you wait weeks? Or can you wait days? Or can you wait hours? And if you're pushing the software out continuously, you need to get that learning cycle down fast. You need to make it short. And when you make it short, you get a new kind of risk profile in your project. Right? You go from sort of your assumptions at the beginning of the project, which might be right or they might be wrong, but if you don't test them until the end of the project, by the time you ship, you've built all of this risk. So the idea is to say, let's test our assumptions early, and then let's keep testing as we go. So you have this continuous learning as you go forward. And continuous learning is, you know, I think some people hear this and they hear test-driven design, right? They hear it's all about the numbers, and they hear it's all about measurement. But that's not really what I mean. What I mean is that you want to be collecting information in every possible way as you go through your project. So you want to be doing qualitative testing, right? The way the sort of qualitative testing that we love and value in the design community. We want to be observing users. We want to be doing usability tests. We want to be working closely with our users to do that kind of qualitative learning. And we do that every week. And then we want to be doing quantitative learning. We do want those numbers. If we can put our products in the world and we can get numbers from the product, right? We can see what people are doing with the product, and then we can use that qualitative test to figure out why. The other thing, I'm not going to talk a lot about this, but we also want to be doing process learning, right? Because I'm going to talk in a moment about the way we work in teams, right? And we always want to be improving our process so that learning, that continuous learning, it's not just about our product, it's about our culture, it's about the way we do work. Now some people say, you know, this isn't how the great visionary breakthroughs happen, right? This isn't how Apple works. They do these big bang releases, right? And isn't this the right one? This like little incremental continuous learning process, that's no good, right? Well, you know, the big bang thing works for some products, but it doesn't work for every product. Any of you use Ping, Apple's social network? No, right? They tried to create social software the same way they tried to create an iPhone, and it didn't work. So processes that work in a manufacturing context don't always work with software. So, continuous learning. Next thing I want to talk to you about is assumptions and hypotheses. Every project starts with an assumption. For example, my bill came in super excited, right? Internet mouse is going to be great. Every project starts with an assumption. Sometimes we call those, we don't like to admit that these are assumptions. We think they're facts, and we call them requirements. But every project starts with assumptions, and it's not just design assumptions, right? It's business assumptions as well, right? So one of the ways that you can de-risk a project is by using a design process across the whole business of your product, right? You take a 360-degree view of the product. So it's not just about what the design is or what buttons we should use, but also who will buy it, who will be the adopters, how will we make money. And when you do that, right, you can start to say, well, these are the things we believe are true, right? How can we test them quickly? Instead of waiting 9 months and building this thing, right, how can we start to test them quickly? Right? We believe our initial adopters will be people who purchase gateway convergence TVs. Right? No one's ever heard of those because no one ever bought them. So this is a hypothesis. This is the structure you use to test your assumptions. Okay? And it's a way of writing an assumption in a testable format. And it has two parts. The top says this is what we believe. And the bottom is the test. We'll know we're right or wrong when we see the following feedback from the market. Okay? And that feedback can be all kinds of feedback. It can be qualitative feedback from a usability test or from an interview or an observation. It can be quantitative feedback. Right? We can measure usage. It can be an effect on the business, what we call a KPI, key performance indicator. And you can use this both at a high level for the business, right? Or you can use it at a detailed level for a feature. Right? So for example, you can say, we believe that by building this feature for these people, right, we'll achieve this outcome. And we'll know it's true when we see. We did this in the workshop yesterday. We made some very simple personas. Right? We plug the personas in here, and we can just sort of figure out how are we going to test our feature ideas. So for internet mouse, we might have said, we believe that creating internet mouse for people who own these TVs will give them a way to control the computer from their couches. And we'll know it's true that these people need this when we see them buying these TVs. Okay? We could have waited for this metric, or we could have looked for something else. We could have said, well, as a business, right, what's our hypothesis statement about the business? Why would we want to do internet mouse? Well, it was 1994, and the thing that we wanted to do was we wanted to get in the internet business. So we thought that if we made internet mouse, it would put us in the internet business. If we were trying to get into the internet business, we could have done it in a better way, cheaper, faster. But we didn't have this conversation about what we were trying to do. So hold that thought, because we're going to talk about it, and we'll talk about outcomes. And we could have known it's true again without ever making anything, just by measuring whether we were getting pre-orders from our retailers. So I talked about this idea of future business, right? Where are all of the assumptions? And in order to do that, you need a complete team. You need a complete team across all of the functions in your business. Okay? Because you can't take a 360-degree view from within a silo. So we talk about this idea of small, dedicated, co-located, and cross-functional teams. And so the attributes of those teams, I need three hands. So we talk about these teams being two pizza teams. So a two pizza team is a team that you can feed with two pizza pies. Okay? That's about, I don't know what Brazilian pizzas are, but the American pizza feeds about two people, three people. So it's about a 4 or 5 person team. Any bigger than that, it's too big. These people are dedicated to a single project, okay? So not switching among many projects, but they have the time to focus on just one project. They're co-located, so they work in the same room. Okay? The idea here is to make the greatest collaboration that you can make. Okay? It's very difficult to do that if you're in different places. And finally, they're self-sufficient. So what does self-sufficient mean? Self-sufficient means that you, first of all, you have all the capabilities you need to ship product. And second, you have the decision-making authority to push features live without layers of approval. So we started to see this happening at some of the large companies that we work with. This is a war room at PayPal in their headquarters in California. And this is a group of software developers and product managers and designers who've taken over a large room together to work on a single project. And PayPal is actually rebuilding they're doing a huge facilities project to pull out all the cubicles and to move people from their design department and their development department and their product management department to move people into small teams so that they can work together like this. And what you'll see, what they're doing here, they're having a meeting, but one of the things that they very often do is they will stand at a whiteboard and sketch together. The designers will sketch on the whiteboard, and the developers will sit there and make a prototype while the designers are sketching in real time, so that by the end of the sketching session, there's live code running. And I'll talk to you in a minute about design systems and how that can enable these people. So how do you get a team to be able to make prototypes live in real time? Okay? You have to, first of all, you have to have a cultural bias towards making things. Right? For a lot of designers, for a lot of UX designers, when we talk about making something, we make things like this. Okay, how many of you use Balsamic or Acture or OmniGraffle? Or Illustrator, right? We make things that are a simulation of the product. Okay, this is Action. Okay? It's a wireframe. Okay? But it's not the real product. So how do we get designers making real product? Well, in that PayPal example, they use a version of Twitter Bootstrap. Now, how many folks here, when I say Twitter Bootstrap, know what Twitter Bootstrap is? Okay, many, many people. But what Twitter Bootstrap is it's a collection of HTML and CSS and JavaScript that includes all of the standard elements you need to make a web application in the browser, just the front end parts. Okay? And so what we're seeing is companies are starting to use things like Bootstrap and they're starting to customize them. So this is the design system that the team at GE has put together. And this was built by designers and front-end developers working together to design a beautiful system, okay, that is embodied in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So the teams can work together to build code that is, to build prototypes that are beautiful and on-brand and use pre-made assets. So when you can build things like this, what do you build? Okay. I'm sure you've heard the expression MVP. In order to move quickly, you need to make small things. And so I like this definition of MVP. MVP is not necessarily the smallest product that's viable in the marketplace. It's the smallest thing that you can make to test your idea. The smallest thing you can make to test your hypothesis. And it's often the case when we have our, you know, when we think about our usability research, when we think about our user research, as a community, there should, I like to think about three big questions. Okay? The first thing that businesses want to know, they want to know, is there an opportunity in the marketplace? And we're pretty good at that. Our ethnographic research can reveal, right, whether or not there's an opportunity. They also want to know, will people buy my solution? In the UX community, we don't do so well with this question. We say, oh, that's market research, we don't touch it. And then the third category of question is, does my solution work? And we're good at that, right? We can make designs, we can build prototypes, we can usability test them, and figure out if it works. But it's the second question that's hard for us. Well, making things lets us answer this question, okay? So, but we don't necessarily have to make a product. This is Kickstarter. Kickstarter's in the website in the US that lets entrepreneurs with ideas pitch an idea for pre-sale. All you have to do is make a video. You don't even have to make a product. You can make a video that convinces people you've got a good idea. And if people fund you, if they pledge money, you know your idea is a good one and you can go ahead. So it's possible that when we think about what we design, we often think we're product designers. That's what we design, but we don't necessarily have to be product designers, right? We can design experiments. We can work with businesses to help them figure out, we're researchers, we know how to answer questions. We can design things that function as experiments and help businesses figure out, will they buy my solution? This is a little experiment that we built for American Express to figure out if their customers would be interested in a decision support tool. And I'm not going to take you through it because I don't have the time, but basically it's a little website, it's a landing page. We bought some Google ads, we put traffic here, and then we just watched. Would people click through? Would they select a plan? Would they sign up? Right. And we just measured these numbers. This website took us, I think, 2 days to build, and we were able to test this idea without really designing or building a product. So when you're moving this quickly, right, it's very typically the case that, you know, we work for a boss who comes in and says, I want you to build this feature. Right? Here's a button. I want you to add this button, add this feature, add this menu, okay? We call that an output. An output is the thing you make. McDonald's makes french fries. But what's the outcome, right? Why do you want the new button? What happens when you put this thing in the world? That's what the business wants. Not all outcomes are good. So if we change the way we manage and we say to our teams, make me the outcome that I want, it gives teams all kinds of ability to think creatively about their solution and to move very quickly, to try one solution and then try another solution and try another to see if you're getting the outcome that you desire. Now there's another level above this, which is sort of the sum of all outcomes. It would sort of be like saying to a team, make my business profitable. It's what happens when you add up all the outcomes. And the reason I want to talk about that is that's too big for teams, okay? One team can't affect an outcome any more than one parent can affect the obesity in the United States. All you can do is take care of your own kids. So when we talk about managing teams, we talk about this sweet spot in the middle, which is the outcome, okay? That's the kind of direction we want to give to our teams. We want our teams to focus not on output, not on features, but on the outcomes that they can create. So for example, this is a story from my colleague, Jeff Gottlieb, who worked for many years at The Ladders, which is a company that helps job seekers and recruiters find each other to place candidates in jobs. One of the things that The Ladders observed was that when job seekers and recruiters exchange emails or exchange messages on site, all kinds of good things happened. Right? More people found jobs, the site made money. So that rate of response between candidates and recruiters was critical. So what the labs did was they asked a team, take this rate, this is 14% at the start of the project, take that rate and make it higher, make it 75%. And so the team went to work and they tried all kinds of different solutions. And after 3 months, they came back to the stakeholders and they said, well, you know, we've got that rate up to 50%. And the stakeholders said, great, work for another 3 months. And they went for another 3 months and they came back. And so after 6 months, they got the rate to 63%. And the stakeholders said, you know what, that's close to 75%, that's good, we're gonna put you on new challenges. So it wasn't about features, it was about how to make the business more effective. So finally, what does that look like in an organization? So far I've been talking about these small teams working together to test the business model, test the product, test all of the assumptions in the business. But what does that look like inside a larger organization? Because the organization has to change to support working this way. So I'm suggesting that there are a few important changes that organizations need to make. And they're not small changes, because they involve the budgeting process and the way we fund projects. So we need our stakeholders in the business to move from fixed budgeting to these sort of small chunk, predictable funding cycles. You have 3 months to work on an outcome. Let's check in on a regular basis. We need to change the way we fund products. We also need to change the culture of our organizations to enable working this way. We need to allow teams to build features that don't work so that they can experiment and fail. And we need to change the technical infrastructure within companies, which is a huge challenge. So the teams have these sandboxes, these test environments, and the tools that they need to push software live on a continuous basis. Okay? So we've got challenges, right? We've got challenges in our stakeholder bodies, we've got challenges in our culture of design and product management, and we've got challenges in the infrastructure. But this is where it's going, right? Software is eating the world, and this is what organizations are going to need to grapple with in the next 20 years. And you guys are the ones who are going to be leading the charge. So, this is what we talked about. We talked about this continuous learning model. We talked about assumptions and hypotheses. We talked about making small cross-functional teams that are laser-focused on solving problems. We talked about making and how important that is. We talked about managing to outcomes, not outputs. And we talked about what a new organization might look like that does all of this. And with that, that's me. Thank you very much.